And then some new approaches. Based on logical neurosemantics. So in fact, it won't be used in any way, but it's certainly going to be very suggested. So a question that was posed a long time ago, close to 200 years, was a question about rationality of algebraic varieties, and that means that if I have X to be smooth projective, so although most of the methods that I will discuss can be used about other fields, so let's fix this to be a smooth projective varieties over the complex numbers. And so, what we want to consider is the field of rational functions associated with this algebraic variety. The field of neuromorphic functions of n variables, and it is well known that this is the field of neuromorphic functions or rational functions associated with Pn. And then this field of neuromorphic functions is a birational invariant. So if we do transformations of our variety X, which amounts to blowing up and blowing down, smooth subvarieties. Then this field of rational functions does not change under these transformations, and as a result, we end up with what we get started with. And so now, if so, call X to be rational. And only if the field of rational functions of X is isomorphic to the field of rational functions of n variables, and this n is equal to the dimension of X over the complex number. So in other words, if a variety over the complex numbers has the same field of rational functions, of neuromorphic functions, as P, and we call such a variety a rational variety. And so, of course, computing the fields of rational functions of neuromorphic functions of projective varieties is not such an easy task. So what we would like to do is to find another criteria for rationality that doesn't involve computing of these fields of rational functions. And so the Hodge theory suggests such an invariant, and let's look at some examples. So we start with P3. And so as Carlos explained, the Hodge diamond of P3 is of the following form, so where this is the dimension of H0, H0, and this is H6. So now, let's say that I take C to be a curve of genus 5. In P3, so I'm out spare of the existence of such a curves, let's say they do exist, and so we can take this P3 and go up P3 in such a curve, and so the corresponding Hodge diamond changes in the following way. I'll need to go up something actually initially. Changes like that, but then if you go up, down something, it's going to look like this in this form. And so this variety is certainly rational because it's obtained from P3 by birational transformations, and as we said, those are birational transformations. This field of rational functions do not change. And so there's one example that is going to play an important role, and we'll be coming back to it throughout the whole lecture. And that is the example of three-dimensional cubic. So this is a projective variety in P4, which is given by the following homogeneous equation.
X4 cubed.
Sorry,
you're at X4 to the 4.
Ah, sorry. So, this is a smooth cubic upper surface, and the Hodge diamond of this three-dimensional variety is given by the following table. So as you can see, it is not any different of this going up and going down of P3 in the curve of genus 5. So on that very particular level, simple level, just by looking at the numbers, obviously we cannot distinguish much. And so here comes the first application of Hodge theory, and that is looking a little bit deeper at the Hodge structure associated with this smooth projective variety. Namely, we come to consider the so-called intermediate Jacobians. So they were introduced by André Weil, but of course the most celebrated application of them was found by Griffiths and his school. And so what Griffiths proposed considering is this part, h21 of x, and then you model by the image of it, in it by the third homology group. And so this is a nice abelian variety. So we can apply this, and we can look at this complex toroid, which happens to be an abelian variety as well, being projective. In these two different examples, so in both of these cases, it's five-dimensional, as the Hodge diamond suggests, and in this particular case, case one, this is equal something which is called the Jacobian of this Riemann surface, and it was denoted by JFC. And in this second case, actually, this is something which is so-called prime variety, and we'll see what it is. I'll invoke an ingenious construction by Gino Fano, done something like in the 1930s. But of course, it's such a construction that, well, it probably goes to Leonardo da Vinci. But in any case, so what Fano did was the following. So he took this cubic and took a line in it. And then he considered all planes in P4 which pass through this line. And so as you can easily compute, there are exactly P2 of such a planes passing through this line. And now I have a line on my cubic, and I have another plane which intersects it. So therefore, since I have an equation of degree 3, so if I intersect this cubic with a plane, so what remains is another curve of degree 2. So I have a family of conics intersecting, obtained by the intersection of this P2s with my cubic, and therefore that gives me a vibration over P2, such that generic fiber is this conic. And then, as you can easily see, there is a curve in P2 over which these conics become singular, namely the equation of degree 2 decomposes in a product of two linear equations. So this is of course for generic choice of the line and for generic choice of the cubic and for the smooth cubic. So now so I have this curve which I'll denote by S. This is the curve over which we have these singular conics. And an easy calculation using the Oppenzel theory suggests that this curve has degree 5 in P2. And so let me outline an argument for seeing that. So basically what we need to do is to find out what are the singular points on a generic this curve. What are the singular quadrics which lie on this curve. And if I have a curve like that, some line in P2, and so I extend this to a hypersurface in P3, it's going to intersect my cubic in a so-called cubic surface, which is going to be the Oppenzel surface. And there's a nice correspondent relations between the lines on this cubic which intersect a given line, and so there are actually exactly 10 of them, and then they do form 5 pairs like that. So I have 5 pairs of singular curves, therefore the degree of this curve is 5. And B2. Any questions? So this variety which we are going to have is obtained like that. So I take the Jacobian of, so I have, sorry, I have this curve which parameterizes all the singular conics. And then so I will give you a curve which parameterizes all these lines, all these pairs of lines. So at each point here I have two lines, and so in such a way I obtain a two-shifted color. And so in this situation, Prim, who was a student of Riemann, defined the so-called Prim variety of the pair of curves S and tilde and S, and it was defined as the anti-invariant part of this, the Jacobian of the curve, maybe the same abelian variety, but associated with this curve S tilde. So you can easily compute what is its dimension. So a curve of degree 5 in P2 is, has a genus 6. And then by Riemann-Hurwitz formula, you take a two-shifted unramified covering, so you can easily see that the curve upstairs, sorry.
Did you mean this curve smooth?
It is smooth for generic choice of the projection. It's a Bertini argument. And so, this is a two-shifted unramified covering, therefore by Hurwitz formula it has genus 11, so the dimension of this prim variety is equal to 5. Not surprisingly, well, we actually were going to claim that in this case this is just this prim variety. So in one case we have a Jacobian of a curve, and in the other case, this is in the case where we put P3 in a curve of genus 2, and in the other case we have this prim variety. So in order to, if we can show that this prim variety can be never a Jacobian of any smooth curve, then we would know that we are having an example of a smooth projective variety of dimension 3, which looks very much like P3 blown up in a curve, but it's not P3 blown in a curve, just because the thing that we have gotten in the Hodge structure as an intermediate Jacobian cannot be obtained by blowing curve. Well, this is where Griffiths actually evoked the glory days, the spectacular results in so-called Andreotti-Meyer theory, which comes down to computing certain singularities of a divisor in this abelian variety, so-called theta divisor. And this is really a very hard analysis. That's actually what made Clemens' career, to show that the singularities of this theta divisor have dimension, sorry, one, and the singularities of theta divisor of this prim have dimension 0. So because of this very deep invariant coming from so-called Androti-Meyer theory, these two abelian varieties are different, namely there cannot be a curve of which this prim is a Jacobian. In fact, much deeper theorem was proven by Mumford approximately at the same time, which actually completely classified all prim varieties which can be found as Jacobians of curves. So that case related to this smooth curve of degree 5 in P2 comes pretty close of being a Jacobian, but it's actually not due to the fact that this covering actually corresponds to a non-theta characteristic. So it's indeed a very tricky calculation, but that's what Clemens and Griffiths did in this papers, which is almost 50 years old by now. All right, so this is the kind of the first, well, one of the many glorious applications of Hodge theory, but certainly the one that I think made people believe in it. So after that, of course, there have been many other cases, and this approach to rationality that was initiated by Griffiths was the main way of actually approaching the rationality question.
In dimension 3.
So, maybe since intermediate Jacobian is certainly defined like that, and so obviously we're talking about dimension 3. And before I want to say that in dimension higher than 3 we are in trouble just because there is no intermediate Jacobian, I just wanted to really show a little bit different approach to the same question of rationality of the very same cubic. And so this actually belongs to someone we all love and know very well. That's Valery Alexeev and his student Gwen. So the approach is again based on the Griffiths' idea of intermediate Jacobian, but instead of computing this theta divisor, what Werner did is the following. So he had a family of cubics such that H0 is a very singular one and actually a very rational one because it's obtained by blowing up P3 in 5 points and then blowing down certain planes passing through them. So it's so called Segret cubic. And so what was an idea for Alexeev is that he considered this family that Carlos was talking about, which is a variation of four structures, not equal to zero, you get a variation of Hodge structures, and then he started the monodromy and so-called vanishing cycles for this family. And it turns out that family, the generation in this family kills half of these vanishing cycles, and so the vanishing cycles for a family of Jacobians and the vanishing cycles for a family of prim varieties behave in a different way. That's how Alexeev and Gwena conclude that that's a different way to conclude that this generic smooth, actually smooth two-dimensional cubic, we get that it's not rational. So this is what the classical theory tells us about the cubics, and the similar methods apply to many other funnels. So basically the main idea is that you take your funnel, you degenerate it to something which is like cubic conic bundle, then you analyze what is the prim variety associated with this conic bundle, and if it cannot be a Jacobian, this is not rational. So there is only one other case, I don't think it's universally accepted, of a funnel which actually has intermediate Jacobian, which is not a Jacobian of curve, and they are direct, sorry, it's not a prim variety of a conic bundle, and there was uncomputed directly the singularities of the theta divisor, and they have the wrong dimension, so therefore this cannot be a Jacobian. There are other methods based on theory of multiplier ideal shifts, which gave you the same results. But, so once again, as Victor insisted, this only works in dimension 3, and just because it is a method that depends very much on this intermediate Jacobian. So now there is a different Hodge structure, which maybe Kaledin talked about, okay? So-called non-commutative Hodge structure. Yeah. All right. So there is another way to talk about this, and this is discussing what Victor talked about, and that is Landau-Ginzburg models. So we will invoke mirror symmetry, although we will not use this mirror symmetry at the end. But certainly, what I'll be talking about is very much suggested by it. So what you learned yesterday from Victor is that if you take the simplest two-dimensional funnel, P2, so you can associate with it something that is called the Landau-Ginzburg model of P2. And then that is C star square with a potential x plus y plus 1 over x1. And so, as Victor explained, this is an open family of open elliptic curves. So generic fiber is an elliptic curve with three punctures. And then there are three other fibers, which are just normal elliptical curve. So now I believe Victor explained what this is for P3. And in this particular case, what we get is something rather similar, just a dimension higher. And again, this is a family of open K3 surfaces, because if you clear the denominators, you get a hypersurface in P3 of degree 4. And you have four simpler fibers here. So now, what you can notice here is that you can treat these two examples that we discussed from the perspective of this mirror symmetry, and so let me do that. So I'll spare you the equations here. So so let's do it first for the cubic, and then do it for P3 going up in a curve. So if you do it for P3, you get a very complicated Landau-Ginzburg model, which has the following geometry. So you have one very singular fiber, which has six component fractional surfaces, which intersect in an open loop configuration, three this way, so, and then three others, which will go this way. And then you have two other singular fibers with ordinary double points, just like here. And if you blow P3 in this curve of genus 5, what you get is what you have here from P3, but also a rather complicated configuration of this curve of genus 5, so it's a I mean, it's something which has six components, and they intersect in a very complicated way. Of course, to go down to, remember that we had to go down, you need to modify this Landau-Ginzburg model. So these are two Landau-Ginzburg models, which kind of look complicated. But what was noticed a long time ago in a paper that we wrote with Victor is that actually there is some difference, and we can formulate the following theorem. Consider this variation of Hodge structure, but this time associated with the Landau-Ginzburg model of P3 blown up in a curve. And so look at this fiber over zero. So what we have is a family of these open K3 surfaces. Let's denote them by Z. And so you can consider this action of monodromy that Carlos was talking about on this lattice, not on the whole lattice, but only on the primitive part, which in this particular case is of rank. And so this monodromy could be strictly unipotent, or there could be some roots of unity appearing here. So in this case, it's indeed strictly important. And in this case, you can compute this is like that. So where epsilon in power 3 is 1, maybe this is a perfect case. And so consider the action of the monodromy. So then the statement of the theorem is that x is rational if and only if this monodromy mu is strictly strictly important. So we do know that this P3 blown up in the curve of genus 5 is rational, so the monodromy is strictly important. And for the cubic, actually, it's not. So this is actually a stupid theorem, because the way it's proven is you know what funnels are rational, and you know what Landau-Ginzburg models are, and so you just look and compare. Actually, I must admit to you here that this theorem might be wrong, and wrong for the following reason. So a long time ago, I was told by Zhukarevich that three-dimensional funnels are like elementary particles. More money you put into them, more they become. So I'm not so sure that we have a complex classification now, but I've lived long enough, and so I have encountered three new funnels in my life. So maybe you encounter others for which this theorem doesn't work just because it's done in a different way. But for the ones that we know, this is certainly correct. All right, so this suggests that maybe we can actually look a little bit deeper into the possible approaches to rationality by using ideas, at least from mirror symmetry. And so that's what we have tried to do with Maxim Kuntsevich in the last, a little bit over a year. Some of his talks came a little bit early. But so what I would like to do is to look at this Hodge diamond of the cubic from a different perspective. So what we want to think about is, is like a diamond associated with a certain non-commutative Hodge structure. But I'll spare you these definitions for now and just formulate the theorem independent of any categorical structure way. And so the theorem is as follows. And
actually.
I personally don't understand everything, so I can put a question mark. So, so let X be a smooth funnel manifold. Of any dimension, and over any field. So then, the cohomology effects have a canonical splitting. Because there are certain choices and there is a certain action of the break group appearing here, which I don't have time to talk about. And the statement of the theorem is that this splitting is a birational invariant. So now, let's understand the statement of the theorem on our favorite example, the three-dimensional cube.
Excuse me, so if you say serve final, you blow up something, so you serve an extra...
Yeah, yeah, so I set this canonical that I need to say that this is modulo of four-dimension too, but... this is why I say canonical. It doesn't depend on the contribution of varieties in dimension, co-dimension to the entire. That's what canonical splitting means, but I don't want to go into details. You're right, but if you blow up, indeed it changes, but it's contribution in co-dimension too, so we forget about it. All right. So let's look at the example of the three-dimensional cubic again. So I mean, I have here the Hodge diamond, and I also have the Landau-Ginzburg model. So we have three eigenvalues. So this is lambda 0, lambda 1, and lambda 3. So the Hodge, the homology of this cubic splits in three parts. So one is this very simple A type of Hodge structure, other is also A type of Hodge structure. This is lambda 1 and this is lambda 2. Sorry, I apologize, lambda 2. Yeah, that's lambda 1. That's lambda 2. And this piece here, associated with this hefty singular fiber, is lambda 0. So, now, if we have this splitting, and so we do know that modulo subvarieties in co-dimension 2, this splitting is an invariant. If we can show in some way that this Hodge structure comes from something that is not a curve, not come from a curve, then since this is a canonical specific and it's birational invariant, we will know that this cubic is not rational. And indeed, this is actually an easy calculation, probably was done to Bondo, by Bondo, but was later published in a systematic way. So if you look at this example, so you have that phi in let's denote by phi the so-called surf functor. Associated with a three-dimensional cubic, and then as Kuznetsov teaches us, this self-functor satisfies the following equation: phi in power 5 is a shift by 3. And this is not how the self-functors for Riemann surfaces look like. So this is not the self-functor for Riemann surface. So before I tell you a couple of words about the proof of this statement, let's do one more example. And this time, of dimension 4. So the cubic that we are considering is this time a cubic in P5. And it's given by this equation. Of course, this is a lie. So this is a so-called Pfaffian cubic, and it's very well known that it's actually rational. But let's say that I'm considering a generic homogeneous equation in six variables of degree 3. And so what I would like to do is to apply what I just said here, apply this theorem to this example. So when I was a child, I was forced to read these stories of Timur and Spiegel, and there was a character, Lavin Konsak, and so when he's about to be executed, they ask him, what do you want, to see your wife or to eat the turkey? And he says, well, I'll bring the turkey. So I'm asked, what do you want to do? And I said, well, bring four-dimensional cubic. So it's about the four-dimensional cubic. So the corresponding Landon-Ginzburg model here is, in this case, four-dimensional, and generic fiber is an open Fano manifold. So you have four singular fibers.
Calabial.
Yeah, it's for the three-dimensional Calabial. And then, you have some complicated fiber here. But the splitting that you get here is of the following form. And so what you have as an application of this theorem is a splitting in four parts. Thank you. So one of them is with this lambda 0. And this is lambda 1. So this 21 splits as a 20 plus 1. And so according to the statement here, this is a birational invariant. So this one, once again, adjusts the dimension 1. And so what we want to do is to analyze this piece. So I take this one out and look at this piece. And so if you know well the theory of algebraic surfaces, so the only thing this could be is either surface of general type or a K3 surface, but there is a certain pairing associated with so-called non-commutative core structures, and that actually cannot come from a surface of general type. This core structure has the wrong deformations, so it's one more than the usual K3 surface, so it cannot be a K3 surface, and so in such a way you can put this cannot come from a smooth surface. So, therefore, this four-dimensional cubic is not rational. So, of course, there are many other fourfolds which has some core structure like that here, so called the Cullen fold, and so on, and so on, so to which this argument applies. And let me just say a couple of words what goes into the proof, and then talk a little bit about different way of thinking about these things. So the way I presented this is, it depends on the Landau-Ginzburg model, and therefore it depends on mirror symmetry, because lambda I was presented at the singular values of these Landau-Ginzburg models. But you can forget completely that you actually have any mirror symmetry. And what you do is you put two structures, one algebraic, the core structure that Carlos is talking about, and the other is also a core structure, but with associated with the symplectic nature of X, so-called A side. And so one is classical commutative core structure that Carlos is presenting to you. The other was called, in a paper that we wrote 12 years ago with Tony and Max, non-commutative core structure. So, but you put them on the same manifold and consider them together, and then this singular values of the Landau-Ginzburg model actually become nothing else but eigenvalues of the quantum multiplication by the canonical class. Any use of mirror symmetry, and so everything is happening on terms which you know. So what you need to do is just compute what these eigenvalues are, but it is known that it's an eigenvalue, sorry, it's a singular, but values of the Landau-Ginzburg model. So now what I wanted to say is that this method of Alexeyev can be actually extended to this situation that we have here. In fact, so in dimension 3, so what you are going to have is X, and then you consider certain degenerations of maximal type, done by something which is called in physics conifold transitions. So the maximum conifold transitions. So in the case of three-dimensional cubic, this is pretty much mirror of this picture that I mentioned to you that was done by Alexeyev and Guenin. And then, so for each of these maximal conifold transitions, namely for these degenerations, so we have a Landau-Ginzburg model. Or if you like, eigenvalues to the quantum multiplication by k. So this conifold transition means that you squeeze a sphere, three-dimensional in this case, and then you do a small resolution of the rational curve. So now, if you start doing this, these Landau-Ginzburg models have many different eigenvalues. And so one can notice that if actually this eigenvalues here appears with some gaps, then this corresponds to non-rational functions. The point is that this story with the gaps doesn't depend on the dimension and can be extended to dimension 5 and higher, I hope. But what it seems to be the case is that the following gaps, which appear in many different, on first sight, subjects, seems to be related. So one is this gap in the eigenvalues of the Landau-Ginzburg models. So the other is the gaps in the Orlov spectrum, which was introduced by Ballard, meaning the gaps were introduced by Ballard. The Orlov spectrum was introduced by Orlov, but the gaps were introduced by Ballard, forget about myself. And then, much older thing, which only I only learned about from Max, and that is gaps in the theory of PD. In this particular case, that is so-called small Champère equation.
Okay, what means gaps in this? The values of the eyes, so they are just some complex numbers.
Yeah, so let me give you an example of what you know. So I take P3 and I do these tricks with an elliptic curve, which is in P2. Cube. So the all possible eigenvalues, sorry, I apologize, that's true, but all possible Landau-Ginzburg. Sorry, singularities of Landau-Ginzburg models that you can get by doing this maximal conifold transition, in this case, 5, 7, and 10. So I think that for a cubic, you get much bigger gaps. So you have 5 again. Sorry, you have 5 singular fibers, 7 singular fibers, and 10. There's nothing else.
So it's just numbers of So not values, but numbers.
Numbers,
of
And so, what I want to end up by is to claim that it seems that this different gaps theory, appearing in rather different notions, could be related to each other and then give a new way to look at these classical questions of rationality. So this would be another possible application of a little bit more developed Hodge theory, but I'll stop here. Thank you very much.
questions?
So, in what you said at the end, you're looking at the A side and then applying the non-commutative Hodge theory on the A side. But does that mean you need to know how to construct the Fukai category?
No. I mean, I think that one day, of course, this statement will be made as a statement about similar formal decompositions. The only thing is that I'll be just dead at that point. But we do conjecture that this semi orthogonal decompositions of degree is operational in the end.
So you're saying that the NC Hodge structure thing you can just define directly?
I mean, yes. But I mean, so you do. So this initial, your Hodge structure is associated with DP. But this thing has also Fukaya category. So the cubic has also Fukaya category.
Yeah.
But we don't need to so the non-commutative Hodge structure is something much simpler than the Fukaya category. You don't need the whole formation of the Fukaya category to define the non-commutative Hodge structure.
Why not?
Because the theorem says that it's the non-commutative structure, so meaning the theorem that you prove with Tony and Mark, says that the non-commutative Hodge structure plus the transition functions determine the Fukaya category. This is much less.
But how, I mean, what's the computation of the non-commutative Hodge structure?
It's just eigenvalues of the quantum multiplication.
Okay.
I mean, so the proof actually goes a little bit different.
So you need Grimm-Whitman variance.
Yes, that's correct. I mean, the proof goes by the behavior of Grimm-Whitman invariance under blow-ups. Actually, it's a little bit more general, but for this purpose, it's good enough. So it's A and B on the same level. That's the idea. So two Hodge structures, commutative and non-commutative on the same variety. But this splitting on the level of homology certainly leads to the splitting of the level of categories. Just we don't know how to prove that this semi-orthogonal decomposition of DB is a variational invariant.
You
know it's a semi-orthogonal decomposition. Yeah. I mean, in the case of three-dimensional funnels, all semi-orthogonal decompositions are understood on level of categories. But if you are interested in questions about rationality, it's enough to just know this decomposition on level of Hodge structure, then see what is this massive piece made of, and if you actually see that it's self-functor is not like a self-functor of a curve theorem. I mean, so this hefty theory of Griffiths and company that have to compute the eigenvalues of, the singularity statistical divisor becomes two seconds exercise. And so this Enos papers and you get to Griffiths.
Other questions?
Do they
call
them? It's a slightly unfortunate technology, that's why it's a little bit. So sorry to talk about it, we just did it.
Yeah, okay. I was talking.
Yeah.
Did you explain what's the relation between gaps of values of the G model and gaps of all of the spectrum?
I don't know. I mean, this is a conjecture, but they seem to be related. Or if you like question.
Okay, no further questions, let's thank you.